Thank you for joining us. And let's give you a mic so that people can hear you. My pleasure. It's an honor that you can join us this biennial. And I think that the very first question I actually have for you is, how do you feel about being included in a biennial?
Well, it's a great compliment, and I'd like to thank the people of Brazil for having me. I'm not really known as an artist, and to be invited, even the third artistic event I've attended, I don't quite know when we get invited, but it's certainly going on, and I've always wanted to visit Brazil, and I'm here, so it's wonderful.
Well, I would like to just start from your very basic biographical background, as I think not a lot of people might be familiar. I think many people have seen the exhibition at the Biennial, maybe not everyone yet.
Yeah.
But it would be nice to start with some, where were you born and your early beginnings?
Well, Sealand, or the principality of Sealand, was originally formed because back in the 1960s, when Bob was retiring in Cuba, there was a concept in England or offshore called pirate radio, and my father had a pirate radio station on a structure in international waters broadcasting a radio signals into the United Kingdom. There were other ones with Radio Caroline, Radio London on ships, and it was in a time when in the UK there was only very, very boring radio. It didn't interest the youngsters. There was no pop music. It was just people talking, what they called chamber music and orchestras, and it was a huge phenomenon. And because the British government couldn't control these radio stations because they were in international waters, they brought in legislation to close them down, which included making it illegal to work on the stations, to fuel them, send fuel out, food, and advertise them, which cut the lifeblood of the, the stations and closed them down. So my father, looking for a better jurisdiction to broadcast from, found this fortress in further out the sea, outside of territorial waters. Took it over, was going to broadcast a radio station from there, and then had this bizarre idea to declare an independent state, and that was back in 1967. And paradoxically, the British government were concerned, and the word they used were, we think this could be the Cuba of the east coast of England. And obviously they fell apart at the seams about it, and they wanted to invade. There were all sorts of, incidents over the years involving the British Navy and other factions. But at the end of the day, my father declared independence. And independence...
How did he go about that? Did he simply...
Well, basically, you design a flag, raise a flag, and declare independence. But at the end of the day, international law is a little bit conceptual, a bit like artwork. In so much as there's no black and white in international law, it's not mostly a matter of opinion. An international law is opinion. It's not like in Brazil you have a law book, you know what is right or you know what is wrong. With international law, it's based on the old Roman law, just gentium, which the Romans governed the world in their time, at the time. And these old laws, modern law, is based on that ancient law. So he went through all the right removals. And the British government didn't know how to deal with it. And of course, over the years, I mean, to have a country, you need, I believe, four sets of things. You need population, the ability to communicate, territory. You know, three or four things. And it was actually, that was brought about in the Montevideo Convention. Roosevelt was there, so we're going back that far. They gave out the guidelines for states. But of course, we're very small, and we are like the mouse of law, we're tiny.
But how many of you were there at that time?
There were just myself and my family and a few members of the staff on the radio station. I mean, I was only about 14 years old when I first had my father. But we've been there 44 years now.
And was there any particular moment where it felt that things were in danger, they would be...
At one point there was an international consortium of German and Dutch businessmen that attacked us, and I was on Sealand on my own, and I was kidnapped and held prisoner for 4 days, and no food or water. I was taken to Holland and landed illegally with no passport on the beach in Holland, and it was a hugely dangerous time of our lives. And my father, in those days, there was no communication, no mobile telephones, no radio transmitters. I mean, we just hardly had contact to see that. But my parents didn't know what was going on until I managed to get to Holland. And we had to re-invade. We got a helicopter, we slid down ropes out of the helicopter.
How long were you captured?
I suppose the whole thing was about 5 or 6 days. And I was taken on a Dutch trawler. A Dutch trawler arrived, and they offered to take me to England or to Holland or wherever I wanted to go. But the captain of the trawler wouldn't take me to England in case he got arrested for piracy and kidnapping. The Dutch authorities, Belgian authorities, were more lenient in these directions at the time. I mean, I suppose these days we call these people terrorists. They turned up, they were armed. They arrived in a KLM helicopter, the Dutch National Airline at the time. And these guys came down on a winch wire. Some of them were business associates that I'd met before. And I believe they raised money, they had a consortium, they raised money to build a small island, reclaim land. And being German, they decided, why share it, we just march in. You know, they closed up on Poland and places like that. But anyway, that's what happened.
Did you ever have second thoughts about being there? Did you ever think about leaving?
I mean, and certainly after this incident, it was. I mean, the people that helped us recapture the island were Sealanders. There were people that were Sealand passports, they were friends. And everybody was so annoyed and upset about what had happened. And, you know, it was no problem at all raising a small team of people to go in the helicopter and recapture it.
And so how about the perception of the, how has the perception or the tolerance of the British government towards Sealand has evolved over the years? Are they now simply accepting and they leave you alone? How do they react to
it? Well, a lot of things have happened over the years, and back in the late 60s, the British government did try to take us by force, and we've had warships out there uncovering their guns and swinging their guns around, you know. British warships was quite an unusual thing to happen, you know. But as the years have gone by, and also after the 1978 incident described with the kidnapping and everything, we got de facto recognition from the German government because we had prisoners of war, and some prisoners of war, they were German nationals. And the German ambassador came out and visited Sealand, which is de facto recognition. I mean, nobody steps forward in the world to offer de jure recognition if they can help it. So over the years, we became more and more established. It's 44 years now. And now I think the British government themselves have a history of running an empire, a vast empire across the world. And they're very clever in the way they do it. I mean, probably what they've done in a lot of things is play the waiting game. They just hope we'll go away with it one day. Unfortunately for them, was my father, was me, and then my son carrying on, and his brother. So.
Do you have the British passport? You take it?
Do I have what?
You have a British passport.
I have a British passport and a Sealand passport, and I always used to travel on a Sealand passport, but we stopped issuing passports after 9/11 because we didn't want to, we were concerned about terrorists and people with ill intent traveling the world, possibly getting hold of some of our passports.